Highly original, colourful, bright, witty, yet down-to-earth, zany are all the ways my guest today has been described. She was born in Chatham, Kent, near the beginning of the war in 1940. Her clothes are eagerly bought by women who can afford them throughout the world. She regards herself primarily as a textile designer rather than a dress designer and sees herself as an artist. Welcome, Zandra Rhodes. Yeah. Zandra, the first thing we must notice about you is this bright pink hair. So why do you have it like that?
Well, I first started dyeing my hair in early 1970 when Fidel Sassoon brought out those pale green wigs. And I didn't like wearing a wig, and so it struck me, well, as I'm a textile designer and they dye sheep, I would have thought my hair would be the same thing as dyeing wool. So I went along to, in fact, Leonard, and I said to Leonard, oh, would you please dye my hair green, you know, and at that time I started off first with streaks and then it got stronger and stronger. And then I went to China in 1979, and I didn't see anything red. You know, they talk about red China, so nothing red. But when I came back, I decided I was going to dye my hair pink. And it's the easiest colour to maintain. Like, it fades a little bit, but you don't have to do too much to it. And I did once have a boyfriend who said, I'd like you to look really natural. You know, the look they call the Jewish princess look. And I then one day let my hair grow the roots to about 2 inches, and it was so heavily salt and pepper that I thought, I can't face it, and I'll go back to being my strawberry blonde again.
But you've got the brown underneath, so why do you have it two colours?
Trevor Sorby, who cuts my hair, knows that I always like little bits to fiddle with, and I don't really feel happy with short hair, but if short hair's in at the moment, so he cut it. So a lot of people said, oh, what about your wig? But in fact, it's my hair, and it's just layered so that the black comes out at the bottom and the pink's still at the top.
How important do you think the look of a person is and the image? I mean, do you worry very much about your image?
I don't have time to think about it. There's absolutely no time at all. For example, if you said to me, well, what about choosing your clothes for today? It was a case of, it was a quick decision of something that I knew would look all right, that I keep hanging in the factory. And in the factory, I wear a tracksuit, and then I just have a change of clothes, and it's put on in a matter of 3 or 4 minutes.
But you do actually choose what you wear to go to different places. So, I mean, you wouldn't go too wildly dressed to a rather sombre occasion.
I think it's terribly important to wear the right clothes for the right occasion, because I think it always shows respect for that particular occasion. Like, if you go to see the bank manager, I'd wear a suit to go and see the bank manager. I wouldn't wear trousers to an evening function, not unless I was in India, where I'd then feel that I should wear trousers to an evening function. And I think that you should always... the rules are always different, because the rules apply to wherever you go. I mean, I rather like the thing that if you're going to dinner at a friend's and you're worried that you'll look too dressed up, I think when in doubt, always dress up, because at least it's a compliment to the host. And does it really matter? I heard a wonderful story once of some friends that turned up in full evening dress to a dinner in the country, and everyone was just in ordinary clothes, but I'm sure the conversation was wonderful the whole evening.
Something else I've been looking at, and you notice, of course, is your makeup. And we've got a picture of you on an Indian poster with really, really about 4 colours in your hair and very elaborate makeup. Does it take long to do?
For those poster shots of that type, it would take about, it's a 4-hour makeup, because particularly the older you get, the more disguises you have to go through to get rid of the wrinkles and do different lighting and things like that. But when I do an image poster, which is about every year, a look that I'll promote that year, whether it's an Indian collection or an African collection, I then would work very closely with the makeup artist. In the case of the Indian one, Yvonne Gold, who did it, my hair was in fact thick with paint. I mean, it was spray holding it right up, and then it was painted on top for the look of the whole picture. But it takes, in fact, about 4 hours till you, and you keep doing Polaroids till it looks absolutely perfect.
Tell me about the collections. You go, I know, on travels, and those seem to be the inspiration for the designs that you have.
The thing about designing, I always think designing is rather like being a tightrope walker. You never know if you're going to fall off. And the only time I get away from the pressures of my everyday work is to go on holiday. And holiday is usually a fairly happy occasion. And in it, I take my sketchbook, and the rule is that I have to do a drawing a day. So I try and pretend that I do fashion. I think I block everything out of mind. But in the back of your mind, you're always thinking, if I don't come up with a new idea for a new collection, I mean, I've got to put a collection on the catwalk, all that sort of fear. So, but the main thing is also to sort of try and look around you and see what there is and just draw something, rather like a notebook. If you were a writer, I suppose you might, like, say, someone like Lawrence Durrell would write about a tree that he sees or a river or a lake. And mine is really to try and analyse things. And then sometimes you come back and it leads to a new collection.
Well, the lilies in Japan started a new collection idea, didn't they? And it's interesting to see how you develop it. We've got some of your early drawings of those lilies from your book, The Art of Zandra Rhodes. And then it's interesting to see how you've developed it. So actually, that's how you started with them.
I started with them. Being in Japan, I sort of had my sketchbook with me, and I wasn't happy because I couldn't speak the language and I felt very trapped. So I sat in the hotel room and drew bunches of lilies that had been given to me. And then because of the fact that everywhere in Japan there's the script and the writing and everything, I then put writing on. But in this case, I used English writing all over the whole thing, and then eventually simplify it by a lot of means till it turns out to be the pattern of the textile, and try out different things, like I might print the one I get and then cut it out and redivide it up till eventually it becomes another textile.
And then you've got your designs eventually, which you call butterflies, but I know it's not the design of the dress that matters so much to you, is it, as the textile and the fabric?
Well, I think that the textile is what you always notice, like the particular dress I'm wearing. One's aware that the stripes do that. On the other hand, the shape of the dress must also feel lovely. You must always feel good at the moment. One needs, say, an extra bit at the shoulders, or you need to feel a bit of glamorous shape. And so you can't just make a sack up out of a bit of patterned fabric.
Absolutely not. You've actually had some very famous people wearing your clothes, because they can be, what, up to £3,000, Zandra, the clothes?
Well, if they're all covered in handwork, they could even be, I hate to say, a little more than that. But I mean, it goes right down to the ready-to-wear line, everything.
A dress of yours, in fact, is a collector's item. They are exquisite. And the beading, as you say, can take... What's the average time if you were beading all over?
Oh, it would take three men, 3 weeks. That's initially
to do it. For one dress?
For one dress in India, where I have a small factory. Then it comes back to this country, where it's made up and hand-rolled all round the edges. Everything I do is made or finished in this country, all hand-done. All around the edge of this dress is all hand-cut in my workroom and all hand-punched to go round.
I bet that's a lovely shot if we've got a close-up of your lovely legs with the frills on as well. The famous people who wore them, does it give you a thrill? I mean, when you, obviously Bianca Jagger was a great supporter of yours, but you had a number of them.
I think that one should always be proud of all the people that support you. I mean, I think it's if you see someone wearing your dress, I mean, it's like a painter who goes into a home and sees one of his pictures on the wall. I mean, apart from what it gave you to create that, it's rather fabulous, sort of like seeing someone in it. It's an honour, you know.
Well, the Parkinson picture of Princess Anne's engagement, that was one of your dresses, a fairy tale dress. You don't often see her in things like that.
Well, originally I thought I'd go into illustration. But in fact, I think one's always influenced by people that teach you. And the person who taught textiles, called Barbara Brown, was a fantastic teacher. And she now teaches at the Royal College. And in fact, that influenced me to doing textiles, which I enjoyed. I loved the sort of idea of doing a pattern that then gets partly destroyed and moves around the body. But then I specialised in dress textiles and not furnishing fabrics. Couldn't find a market for them. Went out to try and sell them. No one would buy them. And I hadn't even got pink hair then. But I did wear big turbans and lots of jewellery.
Yeah.
And so I concluded that if I believed in them enough, and I never doubted that I didn't believe in them, then I'd have to learn to make dresses in order to sell dresses to show how the textiles would look and sell the textiles.
But your mother was in the fashion industry, wasn't
she?
She worked in Paris.
My mother had worked in Paris as a fitter before her marriage, and then she was the senior lecturer in the art college that I came from. But then, one, I didn't particularly want to sew. I loved dressing. I did enjoy dressing up. And I didn't want to be taught by my mother either, so it never crossed my mind to either learn about it or go into fashion. So it was all, after she died, it was something that I couldn't sell the textiles. I hated teaching. And so I went into the business of making dresses.
Do you miss your mother?
Do I miss her? I thought I could never live without her because she is the most strong, amazing, amazing character. But I feel her presence. Now, if you said to me, I'm not religious, nothing, but I feel that her presence is around and she exists, so I don't have any, it's not really that at all. And I feel very strongly that if people die younger, you always remember them at the height of their power, as it were. So it's how she would have wanted it to be.
Are you psychic then, Zandra?
I come from a family that possibly had something psychic about them, but that I and my aunt was Ina Twigg, the medium, who died about 2 years ago. I never had anything to do with it. She once came round to my house to tea and said, I can see flames going up the wall behind you. And I held her hand and I said, Auntie, I don't want to know. You can see what you like, but don't involve me. I don't want to know about it.
Would it frighten you to know about it, you mean?
It does, yes. I think it's...
It would me.
It's good to feel the presence, know that there's a presence, but apart from that, I wouldn't want to be involved with it.
You're pleased that your mother's there, sort of knowing what you're doing, almost,
yes,
you're saying.
Yes, you know.
Of course. To get going was quite hard. I mean, I was very interested to read in your book that your first ideas came from a supermarket.
Well, I think ideas always come... Ideas never come out of nothing. They come out of bits that you scribble on pieces of paper and things like that. So that the first things were when they had those wonderful giveaways on with plastic flowers and things. And you always draw what's around. So if at the time I used to go around supermarkets, the packets were and Warhol was very fashionable then, was to do packages of things and put those onto the textiles. You know, so.
And your first home, I think I'm right in saying, did you have plastic everywhere?
Plastic flowers, absolutely everywhere, all round the bottom of plastic lights and that Fablon, you know, Fablon went round a bar and we made everything with a Black & Decker jigsaw cutting round all these different shapes.
What about friends who came to that house and what is your home like now, actually?
Well, it still has some of that furniture that got moved into my house. I'm usually controlled by what there is available. It's very much like my bedroom is all ruche tulle over the top of gold lurex, which looks very pretty and very feminine. But in fact, it so happened that we printed a whole lot of tulle in a beautiful print and it wasn't finished properly, so we couldn't sell it. So it wouldn't dry clean or wash. So I thought, well, I'll use that in my bedroom.
Do you enjoy your home?
Do I enjoy my home?
You're such a busy lady.
I'm in it so rarely that I enjoy when I'm in there, and I'm always, even like about 7 o'clock in the morning, I'm scudding around spraying the plants and checking out the camellias and things like that.
So the garden side is very important, is it?
Love the plants around, really do. The green fly definitely find paradise in my garden because it's and it doesn't see any sunlight, so it's only got woodland plants with ferns and.
If you've got the slugs and the green fly, just forgive me interrupting you. Do you ever write to programmes and ask for help? Gardeners Question Time.
I did write to Gardeners Question Time about slugs, and they recommended that when I said, well, like they used up so much beer in the slug pubs, and they were still coming and eating all my hostas. They suggested a hedgehog, so I'm still going to try and get a hedgehog. I just haven't got it together. Everyone said it wouldn't live there.
How much do you listen to the radio?
I have Radio 4 on from the minute I get up until I'm sort of like, and if I'm on my bicycle, I always travel with one little ear on. I don't travel with two, but I always have that on to listen to because I don't read enough and I always think it feeds me with information that makes me look reasonably intelligent.
When you say you don't read enough, I mean, you travel to these places. You've been to Japan, to India, to China. How do you spend the time on the flights then? Do you read on those?
I never have more than 5 hours sleep a night, and I try and read on. I take enough reading matter, like two large books, if I'm doing a holiday. I'm not a particularly quick reader, but on planes I usually fall asleep and don't even have meals. I tend to, if I sit in a relaxed position, I go to sleep. You know, it's like a cutout, whereas when you're working all the time, you stay awake.
Do you like postcards and mementos of countries? I mean, have you got a house full of souvenirs or not?
I'm an avid collector of anything that other people would throw away, so my house is getting rapidly full. I collect every postcard that gets sent to me, and they're all filed into albums. But I quite like the fact that you can put all the wrong things together. You know, I'm trying to think. I mean, they could be... I'm trying to think. They could be a page of landscapes, and then you put something that's nothing to do with it, like a picture of the Queen. You know, you try and think of an absolutely rather like a Spike Milligan type of contrast that there's no meaning for.
Mm. What about people living with you? I mean, you've never been married, Zandra, have you? But you have had a lot of lovers, I think. I'm sorry. I've noticed that through the book it says, and then he influenced me for a good number of years, and then somebody else influenced you, you know, and I've just thought, oh, good, that's lovely. She was in love and it was all happy.
I think that women blossom much more if they're in love. I think that even if you're supposed to be what the world imagines as a tough woman, I think there's no replacement for if you happen to be in love and with someone. And I think it does nothing but help your work, because it gives you a basis which you can sort of rest on, and you're a woman as well as someone who is carrying out a job of work.
Mm. What sort of men do you like?
I like achievers. I like people who I have to admire their work. I like someone that will put their work before me. And
do you? Work before you, totally.
So that they believe in their work. So mm. I would be, if one was going on a trip, they would be working on what they had to do as well. Because if you have someone that is sacrificing for you, then they resent you in the long run. Whereas if someone, I'd say quite proudly that a lot of people that I have been with, their work is also at the height when they're with me.
What, photographers, you mean, and people?
Well,
like
I mean, yes, mm. it's a period when both of us, I would do probably beautiful drawings and feel very inspired, and like in the case of someone like Grant Mudford, who is lives in Los Angeles and does wonderful photographs. Actually, he's just at a big exhibition in Australia. But he does beautiful work, and he'd be taking photographs and I'd be drawing, you know, so it would be, mm-hmm. It was rather wonderful.
Los Angeles, I think, according to also what you say in your book, is perhaps a very favourite place.
I enjoy it. I mean, the weather's always lovely. It's always quite mad. There's lots of things happening. Mm. I don't know. I find that, for me, I can always pull my work together and design in this country. There's something about this country that I love. So although I'm in America 6 months of the year, either selling or promoting, this is where I design. This is where I come back after I've assimilated the ideas.
Mm. Tell me about some of the other places you've been. I mean, what was your reaction to India?
India, I was first invited by the Indian government to do an Indian collection. So I travelled all around. They said, where would you like to go? So I looked at a map and spoke to a few of my friends, and I looked all around at where it might be possible to go to. And I then travelled with a sort of like quite a heavy, not quite a backpack, but with the cameras and sketchbooks and sort of sit down. I went to Jaipur and I sat down there and I draw different things that I saw.
I've got actually a lovely picture of what you did draw in Jaipur.
Oh, the Indian
here.
One. That was a year ago last
year,
isn't
it?
Yes.
Yes. And that's what I think. That is beautiful. I mean, you are a very good drawer. What a thing to say to you.
They're pentails on Japanese sketchbooks, these wonderful sort of, I think it's rice paper. It's very thin, but it's nice. It's quite light to carry. It doesn't crease too badly, and it takes the colour nicely, so you look as if you've got a pretty drawing afterwards.
Yes. And that colour is, I mean, that is beautiful. Where's that?
That was the
Indian
sunset just outside of Bikaner, a sort of like a wonderful wall of a temple. And I find to draw, if you take photographs, okay, you get a wall full of photographs, but it never has the same meaning as having to look at that and look at how that spire actually went and analyse it and do it at the time.
Mm. Where next? Have you got journeys lined up for the future that you want to go to, places you want to see?
I'd love to go to Egypt. It's always held a lot of romance. I think it could be very fruitful.
Mm, you are actually a very romantic person, I think, aren't you?
I suppose I am underneath.
Yes. What about the friends you have around you? What sort of people do you like? And also, I think you've done Desert Island Discs, and I was longing to know what you took for your luxury. Can you remember?
My luxury. I think I took my sketchbook.
Did you?
I think I took my sketchbook and I took a cookery book which would teach me how to, which seeds and all these different things I could eat, all sorts of hippie food.
But do you get the chance to go out? I mean, I know Janet Street Porter's a great friend of yours, isn't she, Zandra?
And
friends matter, yes, to you very
friends
much.
Friends matter to me very much because they either have to listen when I'm feeling very depressed or they sort of like say, come on, Zandra, we're doing this. Come on, get out of yourself. Or like I see a lot of artists, Andrew Logan, the sculptor who made these earrings, and he does all the jewellery for my show.
Mm.
And he also is a sculptor in his own right, and he came to India with me on one of the trips. And I like friends that have got their own thing happening for them, nothing to do with fashion, because it gets back to you in another way. Dougie Fields, a painter, you know, whose work I collect.
Mm. We haven't talked about any of the young sort of designers who are coming up now. I mean, what do you think of the present state of British fashion and the designers themselves in this country?
We've at the moment got a wonderfully exciting fashion scene. I mean, I'd just like to have even enough time out of my own business to even explore and see what's going on, because I think we've got talent in this country that we should be so proud of.
Mm. And how do you envisage seeing the future? I mean, what would you hope for yourself that the future's going to hold? Do you want to be old and grey or what?
I can't imagine being old and grey.
No, I can't imagine you being old and grey now, I say.
I think I'd like to be a rather grand old lady that probably becomes so formidable that I remember once talking about Deanna Vreeland, who I admire terribly in New York, the fact that I went into her room and she was so exotic and what she had to say and the way she moved her arms was so amazing that when you left the room, you couldn't remember what she looked like. And in the same way, people would say, well, there's something about her, but except if someone caught you in a still photograph, like, say, the Colette picture or something, no one can remember what I look like because I either move around or become a bit unbelievable. Mm.
And, of course, you won't have children of your own now, probably. So is that something you're sorry about?
I think women who don't have children, there must be some form of unfulfillment. I think I have been through periods when I would have liked children and it just never happened because I think it's terrible. Even if you end up as a one-parent family, I think the most important thing is that women usually want children. It's a form of something in your nature that you aren't in control of, but it's if you're in love with someone. I think that's a logical outcome.
Mm-hmm. What you do have, and which we have the pleasure of seeing, and people all over the world have, are your designs, and it's a great pleasure to have had you with us today, Zandra Rhodes, and had you talk about them. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.